The pressure from constituents is killing the members of the National Assembly, says Benjamin Kalu, spokesperson of the House of Representatives. And why are governors against the autonomy of state institutions? Well, this is Plus Politics, and I am Mary Anna Cole. The House of Representatives have complained that its members were facing undue pressure from their constituents over high expectations, stating that its members were developing various ailments and dying. Spokesperson of the House, Benjamin Kalu, said it wasn't the job of the Parliament to implement the resolution and build social infrastructure, but make laws for the country. He also attributed the delays in making reports public to the COVID-19 pandemic, which slowed down the pace of work. Well, joining us to have this conversation is legal practitioner Emmanuel Umoran and public affairs analyst Babasola Adegbuyi. It's good to have you join us, gentlemen.
It's a pleasure to be here this evening.
All right, great. I'm going to start with
you.
Yeah, I'll start with you, Barrister Emmanuel. You are an officer of the law, so... how is it that constituents are putting undue pressure on members of the House of Representatives? How many Nigerians really know their House of Rep members' constituency offices or even the duties that they have been assigned much more than... I mean, how much less can you even say that they are putting undue pressure on them? I want to understand that aspect. Are they really... putting pressure on these officers?
I think that was a statement that one must take with a lot of pinch of salt. The thing is that the legislators are living larger than life. If they take constituency allowance, they pay themselves so much, and they don't care about what is happening in Nigeria and to Nigerians. Really, if what have they done? What have they completed? They said they were investigating Niger Delta. They never ended that. The energy electricity probe that they had during President Yar'Adua's time never ended. They will never saw the report. So many investigations have been done. We've never seen their reports. And when they leave, when they come back home, these guys were our neighbors. They were our friends. The lifestyle they live now, is it the same lifestyle they lived before? The people are seeing them, are seeing that they live beyond the means of the average person. We, some of us have traveled out of this country. We see how legislators live. They don't live beyond their environment. Some people are legislators and are legislators for 50 years. They don't move away from their environment. But what happens in Nigeria? Once you are an honorable member or a honorable member, you cannot live with your people anymore. If you most of them live, even councillors, leave their local government and go and stay in the city, in the capital. So the people see this. You cannot hide from the people. That is why the people come to them.
But it makes me ask the question, do these representatives know their job inside out? Because I'm wondering, I'm going to ask the same question to the next, our second guest, but if they know what their duty is, they should understand that pressure comes with that assignment.
Oh, definitely. And when there is no delivery of the dividend of democracy, look, I watch television, I watch MSNBC, I watch CNN, I watch BBC. Look, politicians talk about the number of persons who have jobs in their country. It's an issue. How many times have our people spent time discussing jobs for people? The politicians want to create jobs, not so in Nigeria. All they're interested in, Every time you hear debates in the National Assembly, it is over money. We have laws in this country that are 45 years old or 65 years old that have not been amended. We have laws in this country that still bear pounds and shillings as punishment. We changed our currency since 1973. Almost 50 years ago. And we have legislators who earn such fantastic salaries doing nothing. And they come home, they drive the best cars, they are building houses, they are building estates. Why would the people not reach out to them for palliatives? What we call palliatives today.
Yeah, let me go to Babasola Adebuyi. Babasola, you ran for the House of Representatives, if I'm not mistaken. And I'm going to ask the same question to you. How well do our representatives know and understand their duties? Because, I mean, I also know that we, the people, need to be updated as to what the responsibilities of senators and House of Representative members are, legislators in general. But are we putting the kind of pressure that we need to put on these men to carry out the responsibilities that they asked us to duly assign them?
Yeah, thank you very much. Let me just make a correction. I did not run for House of Representatives. I was actually a governorship candidate of Ogun State in 2019 election.
Apologies.
So based on your question, one thing I found out is that most of the people actually running for House of Representatives, or let me say the lawmakers' positions across the nation, most of them don't actually know what they are running for. Most of them, when they are campaigning, they don't actually talk about the law they are going to introduce that will make the life of the people better. Some of them will be talking about how they will make money, and they will try to do some projects. They will send some people on scholarship. Those were the promises they give to people, to the electorate, to the masses, whenever they are campaigning. Now, they are now in the House of Representatives. They are now in the position to make law. And we are all aware of how much these people are making, despite the fact that they are denying that they are making up to 23 million naira in a month. And up to now, they have not been able to prove what they are claiming. Now, we are all aware that they are collecting constituency projects. So when you collect constituency projects, and the people are not seeing the project you have executed, definitely they will come to meet you and ask for more from you. They will ask for money from you. The people, if you are claiming that no money has been given to you, don't forget that you have colleagues in other states, you have colleagues within your state who are doing projects in one way or the other. Some are doing empowerment, some are doing road construction, some are building schools. From the money they are giving today, if other people are seeing your colleagues are doing this, you don't have any excuse. So you will have a lot of demand from the people you have made promise to before getting that position to occupy the National Assembly. So what Kalu actually said is right, but for me, that was not the first reason why the people are dying. If anybody dies as a result, if anybody dies in the National Assembly, I don't want to agree it's because of the demand of the people. The demand of people is not much. Give us what you promised us, and that is just it.
Interesting.
Thank you.
Now, let's go back to some of the things that Kalu said, which he is the spokesperson of the House of Representatives, for those who are wondering. He said Nigerians mistake the functions of the executive to be duties of the legislature. So I ask, how much information and education is out there for the populace to understand, so that they can be able to ask these necessary questions and ask in line with the duties and responsibilities of these officials? Again, especially in terms of voter education, like you said, Babasola, when these people are making promises, those promises don't even align with the duties that they're going to be assigned when they get to the House of Representatives. So, Barrister, how much education and information is out there for the average Nigerian? Does the average Nigerian understand the duties of a legislator in this country? And do we have the NOA and all the people that are assigned voter education responsibilities giving that information to people so Nigerians can decipher between the job of the executive and the job of the legislature?
Thank you. This is a very germane question. The essence of governance in Nigeria, unfortunately, is not good governance. It is how much money you can make for yourself. That, unfortunately, that is what you see everywhere. People who were your friends before suddenly get into political office, they become superstars. They become wealthy people. Now, it is the line, the thin line, because you see, to make money, you need to step away from your job as a legislator. You need to start acting in an executive capacity, because there is an executive that spends money. So we have this problem of where the legislators, most times, leave their duties and functions of as legislators, as lawmakers, and try to become executive. You remember the fight Obasanjo had with the House members of the National Assembly over constituency allowance, constituency projects?
Yes.
It was a major fight, and the National Assembly wanted to impeach him because he insisted that members of the National Assembly did not have any business executing projects. But they argued that they were the people that were elected by the, they were closer to the people, and that because they were closer to the people, they knew what the people wanted. That was how they got this constituency project money.
But interestingly, are they closer to the people? Because again, some of the questions I ask members of the National Assembly is, how many people know your constituency offices? Where are they located? Can the people access you?
Nobody knows
them. If they need to get through to you, are you closest to them?
These are the problems. These are the problems we have. And I think, good, you are focusing on this. I think there is a need for more journalistic work to go down to these constituency offices and determine who and who has constituency office. And what is the, how many people are working there? How functional is that office? You see people build their own houses in their village and call them constituency office. Is that a constituency office? It's supposed to be a functional office where people can go and make lay complaints. I don't know. I live in Lagos. I've lived in Lagos for over 40 years. I don't know a member of my House of Assembly, because they only come and somebody has picked them. They didn't campaign. They didn't come to seek my vote in my street. You only hear them a week to the election. They bring musicians and they play all over the place and they go away, because they know that you and I do not have any say.
But is that really the case?
How they become,
is that really the case?
Yes.
Can you really say that we don't have
because
a say?
If they knew that you could change your mind and not vote for them next time, they would take their duty seriously. It is like now, I don't prepare for murder and I go to court. I expect most probably to lose the case.
Interesting.
But if I prepare, then I'll meet the case head on.
But
so we need to get serious. We need to stop these things of, yes, you can have political godfathers, but let the political godfathers do what Chief Obafemi Awolowo used to do then. Make sure that you are capable.
Okay, Babasola, I'm going to come back to you, Barrister. There have been several investigative panels that have been set up over the years, especially under this government and previous governments. Several investigative hearings that are still pending, e.g. the NDDC situation, the PIB, which is also being heard right now, and several others. And some of them, you know, die a natural death. Sometimes, you know, they're forgotten and then we go on business as usual. Why do you think that this keeps happening?
Well, based on that question, personally, I've given up on the committee coming out with a report. I've given up a recommendation from committee. I've given up on those things. Because since 1999, I can't remember any government executing recommendation from any committee in respect of the findings of that committee investigating a particular ministry, perhaps, status or project. It has become a norm to expose the people who were there. And when we expose them, then we now cover it up. And at the end of the day, nobody will ask question. Nobody will go to court in respect of it. Even if you go to court, then the next question will be asking, what is your home business? They have done their own, and it is time for the people there to make things better. If you are talking of NDDC, despite the secrets, despite all the things that were exposed last year, from how projects were given to the members of House of Representatives or members of National Assembly, how they were projects given to politicians in the nation, and none of the project was actually executed in that particular, in the state they were given to. And at the end of the day, we know all these people, and it now came to, everything has now gone to, what's it called, off the mic. They have off the mic, and the mic is no longer sounding, and nobody is hearing anything again in respect of that.
So I ask, how do we hold these people, accountable?
Not actually helped us. And why is the system has not actually helped us? No, we in Nigeria, we don't know what is called accountability. We don't know what is called responsibility accounting. Nobody is ready to ask questions. All we do is to expose. How many times has the governor or the president asked his ministers to present account of what has been done? It's not only a matter of dishing out money. It's a matter of what has been done. Call the committee. This is what we have done. So what is your recommendation? Let the people that will look into it, if it's a recommendation that requires the jurisdiction, judiciary, send it to the judiciary. If it is one that requires the executive to work on, let the executive work on it. But in this situation where they just put it on one side and everybody will be laughing and we all forget about it.
So what
let me
do
tell
we
you,
do?
Nothing will come out of just the committee report, nothing. Everything will be a thing of the past because now everybody is not counting on 2023. The only time that we talk about those reports is if your name is on that list and you are contesting for a particular post, that is when they dish your name out that so-and-so project, you collected so-and-so billions of naira, you are not able to deliver. So therefore, you cannot. So it's just to blackmail politicians and not for anything.
So what you have told me, Mr. Babasola, what you have told me is that there is no accountability. Government cannot check itself. There's no checks and balances as long as these people are in power. So how do we, the people who have assigned them these roles and responsibility, watching from the sidelines and seeing that they're not being responsible to us, how do we get them to be responsible? How do we get that accountability, whether they like it or not?
Well, it's unfortunate most of us don't actually know our responsibility as citizens of this country. The people are those that will actually mount pressure on those that have the responsibility to carry out the job. But you find out that when you, as a person, you are the one now carrying out the job, maybe taking the court or the National Assembly to court, and you discover that you are being threatened up and down. So someone who has that boldness to do that and being threatened, you actually withdraw. And not that alone, by the time we have Serap. Serap has been doing a lot of things, taking the federal high court. What has been taking the federal government to court? Taking the National Assembly to court? What has come out of it? Nothing. So people need to have this understanding that the government is accountable to us. You don't put people there, you don't spend your money as in your tax, you don't give them your tax, and do not ask questions how your tax is being expended. So we have a lot of orientation to do, and that orientation, for me, anybody that is above 25 years of age now does not need that orientation. We need to start from primary school now. We need to start from primary school. Maybe we have to introduce it in our syllabus and let people know the good understanding of what a good governance is, what a good leadership is, and not just about putting people in the position, ask questions, and everybody will put it aside.
Well, that responsibility, again, falls on government. But I'm coming back to you, Barrister Emmanuel Moran. In other climes, like you said, in saner climes, every time I watch a Boris Johnson, on the floor of the parliament, every time MPs stand up to make a statement, either they're arguing with him or they're in support of him, most of the time they make reference to their constituents and they prioritize their constituents because these are the people who gave them the mandate. So whatever deal they cut, 80% of the time, it has to be something that would benefit their constituents. But the reverse is the case here in Nigeria. I'm talking about allowances. I'm talking about the fights for cars and, you know, benefits and all of those things. It trumps the idea of representing, because representing means that you are here for a person or a group of persons. So in terms of all of these things, the budgets and, you know, all these things, how can we as Nigerians, I already asked him how we can get accountability, but how can we, because he's now said that education needs to be done, but education can only be implemented by the Minister of Education, who also is part of the government, who's been appointed by the president. So if all of these people represent the group of people that we the people feel are not necessarily representing us the way we want to, where does this leave us? Because he just painted a gloomy picture. Where does this leave all of us now? And 2023 is just around the corner.
Where it leaves us is where we are descending to. We are getting into an abyss. If you look at this year, a report came out that the contract, the rail line that was just launched a couple of days ago by Mr. President, that by AU standard, it was 100% overpriced. By AU standard. And AU standard is below the World Bank standard. That among African countries, we are 100%. If it was to cost $5 million in other African countries, as same rail line, same project is costing $10 million. And we have members of the National Assembly who swore an oath to defend the Constitution, to defend, to put Nigeria first. Not one of them has said anything. Not one. How do these people think? And this is borrowed money. Their children will pay back this money. However, I don't think they are very interested in that, because all of them are purchasing citizenship of other countries. Their children are now having dual citizenships. They do everything possible to make sure their children go to school abroad. When I was in secondary school, when I was in university, I had classmates whose parents were commissioners, were ministers, and governors. It was a special school. I went to Lee Family College. I went to university in Calabar. So I went to primary school in Warri. We had friends who were our mates, whose parents were very well-to-do. They went to the same school. So when you have this kind of tsunami or bombastic announcement that our country's projects are 100% higher than the average in AU, and nobody has seen that we are running into an abyss. The country is going at high speed into an abyss.
All right.
When I got into the university, the first time I traveled out of this country to the UK, I had 300 naira.
Well, that's not the case any
My
longer.
First trip
that's not the case
from
any longer.
Calabar to Lagos.
That's not the case. Everything has changed.
Cost me 20 naira.
Well, I want to thank you, Barrister Emmanuel Moran, and of course, Babasola Adegwu. We're out of time. Emmanuel Moran is a legal practitioner, and Babasola Adegwu is a public affairs analyst. And gentlemen, thank you so much. Even though this conversation has ended in a mood that, you know, would make us wonder really where we're going from here, but thank you for being part of the show.
Thank you
for having us.
All right, we'll take a short break. And when we come back, governors continue to oppose autonomy of state institutions. And the big question is, why? We'll talk about it after this break.